series on why does it matter? And we're hitting some heavy-duty topics. Today's topic is on human sexuality. If you have a student that is in fifth or sixth grade and you would like to just send them along, feel free to head right out to the gym. They got lots of fun stuff going on out there. But I think you'll be blessed by today's topic. It's something we don't talk too much about church, and it's probably to our shame and detriment that we don't. And so with that opener, let's get going. There was a Sunday school teacher, and this Sunday school teacher was working on the Ten Commandments with his kids. They got to the seventh commandment. Little Johnny stuck his hand up. He said, "Teacher, what does it mean, thou shalt not commit agriculture?" This guy was smart. And that teacher, Mike, looked him right in the eye, and he said, "Means you don't plow another man's field." Guys, you know, for millenniums, we were an agricultural society, and so it was much simpler times. I think this topic, just by the way that man related to nature, was a lot easier to talk about. We've got to this place now where we're kind of upside down as a society. I don't think we talk about enough about these sorts of things in church. The working title for today's sermon was, it first started out the nouns and verbs of human sexuality. But I very quickly changed the topic as I got into it a little bit farther to the myths and truths of human sexuality. Now, if this is too painful for you, I'll tell you this little sermon illustration, and you'll get the whole sermon in this if you just go home and think about it. But it comes from an old man, and his wife with an English accent. When this man was young, he was going to backpack across Europe. You know, and I think, who hasn't thought about backpacking across Europe? There was a problem, though. He was going to backpack across Europe with an M1 carbine and a knapsack full of ammunition, grenades, and sea rats. You see, he was a soldier heading into the European theater during the World War II conflict. He stopped off in England. And at the stop in England, you go to the USO, and you just try to be a young man, you try to forget about what's coming. Whilst he was at the USO, there was a notebook there, and you could sign up for a pen pal if you wanted to do that. And the soldiers were promised that they would get a gal to write to them. Well, that sounded pretty good to this fellow. And so he signed up. And it wasn't too long thereafter that he received a letter from this gal just outside of London. And so they began this correspondence. Here's this guy who doesn't even know if he's going to be alive for lunch, writing to this girl out in the English countryside. Well, as they exchanged letters, a wonderful thing began to happen. He realized that she loved literature, and particularly poetry. So did he. She described the countryside to him. He was also a country boy, you know. And those letters quickly became an anchor in his life that he so looked forward to. You know, whenever the mail would catch up to him, you know, he'd ship faithfully a letter to this gal, and she would write to him. And he realized that something wonderful was happening, at least within him. There was a stipulation made early on in the letters that there would be no photographs exchanged. They didn't know what each other looked like. And so, miracle of miracles, he fought his way all through World War II, and he was still alive. Now, in order to get back to the US of A, you got to stop in England. And he could not wait. And he wrote the girl a last letter, and he said, "I will be coming to England at such and such a time. I would love to meet you." Before he got to England, the last letter caught up with him, and love to meet you too. I will meet you outside the train station in London with a rose. That guy could not wait to get to London. He got to London. He got to the train station. He looked around, he scanned the crowd, and he saw a woman with a rose. She was about 50. She was about 5 foot tall and 5 foot wide. And he looked at her and he gulped. And then he thought of all the beautiful letters that had been exchanged and how he just loved this woman to the depth of her soul. And it would be rude, at least not to go over and introduce himself. And so he walked over and he gave her just an embrace and, you know, a kiss, a polite kiss on the cheek. And he says, you know, hi, my name is, you know. Said, I want you to know that your letters sustain me heart and soul all the way across Europe. You don't even know if I'd be alive if it weren't for those letters. I want to thank you for your friendship. And the lady goes, whoa, whoa, whoa. Let me back up a little bit. I'm probably not who you think I am. This beautiful young woman gave me this rose. And she said, if she thought that the young man that came up to me was worth meeting, that I'd be in the cafe across the street. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the depth of what human sexuality is intended to be. Human sexuality is the engagement of the mental, the emotional, the spiritual, and once those three are anchored, the physical, in a relationship that God intended for us to have that would take us out of this world. Those of you that are blessed to be married to a wonderful spouse such as myself, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Now last week I talked about the topic, and you know, I was trying to be sensitive a little bit, so we're going to talk about this thing that rhymes with, it's the 19th letter of the alphabet, rhymes with Tyrannosaurus Rex, alright? So, let's talk about the facts of Rex, alright? Probably spelled W-R-E-C-K-S. Tyrannosaurus Rex. This is from Pew Research Center. It's a kind of a nonpartisan research center. They are not Republicans or Democrats or liberals. They just run the facts. Here's the facts. In 1960, 72% of Americans were married. 68% of them were in their 20s. In 2008, 52% of Americans were married. 26% of them in their 20s. When asked the question, is marriage obsolete? 40% of all people that were asked that question said marriage is now obsolete. 44% were between the ages of 18 and 29. The failure rate of marriages in the United States of America is 50%. If you get to the second marriage, it's 70%. These are just facts. From the U.S. Census, cohabitation in 1990 was 3.2 million people. In 2010, it was 7.5 million people. From 1890 to 1980, the average age of marriage for women happened in their early 20s. For men, it was in their mid-20s. By 2010, the average age for women marrying was almost 27. For gentlemen, it's almost 29. This is just biology. The best years for pregnancy occur in the 20s. After that, it reduces down to 20% from 30 to 35 and decreases after that. Educational statistics on sexual behavior. I didn't realize this. The state of Ohio is the only state that doesn't have a mandatory sex ed program, and that's not all bad. Let me share with you what the national recommendations are. For second graders, you should have the proper name of body parts, including male and female genitalia, to be able to explain that all living things reproduce and identify the types of family structures. Did you catch that? Identify the types of family structures. Show respect for them and identify healthy ways for friends to express their feelings. By the fifth grade, you should know how the reproductive system works, explain the changes that come during puberty, define sexual orientation as attraction to another person or a person of the same gender, identify a trusted adult to answer any questions, and know how HIV is transmitted. By the eighth grade, you should be required to identify credible sources of information about sexual health, describe how society influences body image, explain the range of gender roles, and interact respectfully with all people, regardless of their age or gender role. That's the recommendations of the United States of America on their sex ed program. From the state of Ohio, statistics from 2013, 4 out of 10 high school students have had sex. 1 out of 10 high school students have had sex with 4 or more people during their lifetime up to age 18. And 3 out of 10 high school students reported having had sex in the last 3 months. Lest we just pick on the young people, it is true that STDs have exploded. The number one population is from 15 to 25. You want to know what the number two population is? Age 70 and up. STDs are rampant in nursing homes. Florida is a mess, right? How's that? You know, it's a crazy, crazy world out there, folks. Unwed moms are 4 out of 10. Mothers in America are unwed mothers. This is tough on single parents, children. Children born into these situations are prone to lower academics, likely to earn less money, have a higher percentage of health and mental issues. There is also a greater likelihood of high school dropouts, trouble with the law, unemployment, decreased probability of college attendance, and there is a very high potential of second-generation single parenthood. You don't think we have a problem? We have got a huge, huge problem. I would contend that the church gets on the business and on the job of teaching proper human sexuality. And that's what today we're going to talk about. I was a school teacher for 20 years. You know what I give the church? A to F? I give us a G, all right? We are lower than F. We have done a horrible job of the people of God in presenting the proper picture of human sexuality. Today we're going to bust 6 myths, and we're going to talk about the correct response to, and the correct response and the correct approach to human sexuality. Why is marriage declining? Why are we having this problem? Well, the first problem is there's a reinterpretation of the Bible. It's started way back in Genesis chapter 3, and you'll remember in Genesis chapter 2, Adam and Eve were created, and here was the deal. Whatever God said, that's what we did. That's how we approached life. And how we felt about it was second. And so what happened after that fruit was tasted? What happened then was my feelings supersede what God has to say about life and obedience and holiness and any other thing. So, me first, God second. That attitude has permeated mankind and given us trouble ever since. We reinterpret the Bible to the way that we want to read it. That's problem one. Problem two is that issue that I just mentioned. We want to be in charge. Me first. If I'm happy, that's great. Whatever anybody else thinks, too bad for them. It's not about my spouse, it's not about my child, and it's certainly not about my society. I'm going to resist conformity and the complications that brings on my happiness. George MacDonald, a wonderful writer and speaker, said that one principle of hell is I am my own. Right? So, that's where we're starting from. Let's debunk some of this stuff that's out there in society and in here in our church. Myth number one, God is anti-sex. False. God is so overwhelmingly pro-sex, and he gives this gift to us for four different reasons. Reason number one, it's a reflection of His image. A reflection of His image. We got to use a little humor here and there, you know. Man, you guys are looking pretty stiff, so let's loosen you up here a little bit, all right? One of the obvious differences between males and females is plumbing. All right. I remember, I like going for a run in the morning. So I go for a run, and you know, when it was summertime, and we got a new baby, and I am just, you know, I peel my shirt off, and I throw it down, and you know, I'm out on the porch just enjoying a nice cool glass of water, and I got my Bible, and I'm reading and relaxing, and I hear a baby screaming their brains out. You know, they're saying, "Mike, get that baby!" So I go on to get whatever baby it happens to be, and I pick that little baby up. And for those of you that don't have children yet, there's what's called a dad jiggle. Where's Nick? You know, here. And Graham, all right? I'm going to teach you this. It really works great, right? Take this little baby like this. And just jiggle him like this, and rock like this. You know what that little baby did? It was disgusting. That baby latched on. Males and females. God created mankind in His own image. In the image of God, He created them. Male and female, He created them. Now, it's not just plumbing that men and women are different. Guys, we are problem solvers. We are problem solvers and we are conquerors. And that's how God made us. You doubt that? Go back to Genesis and look what happened with Adam. Where was Adam dropped? He was dropped into the garden, right? And I think it wasn't just because the Lord wanted fruits and veggies, all right? It was because Adam was created to solve problems. He was going to get in there, and he's got to figure out how to plant this stuff. You got bugs, you got weeds, you got work to do. Most men that I have met are wired for problem solving, and they are also about the business of work, aren't they? Let's get on it, right? Not so with gals. Gals are extremely relational. They are the nurture and the glue in the family. And if you want to watch something hilarious, particularly like with newlywed couples, watch them try to figure this out, all right? The guy comes home from work. He's had it. I mean, he's put in a full day's work problem solving. Do you know how many words are in a man daily? We might have like 20, 25,000 words, right? We've had it, right? At the end of the day, we're shot. He comes home to see his beloved woman. This woman has been waiting for him all day long. Do you know how many words are in a woman? Me neither. Research says that there's 50,000 words in a woman with gusts of 60 and 70,000. All right? You girls got a lot of words. And so here comes the guy and he's shocked. He just wants to sit down and catch his breath. And the woman, you know, and she starts telling about a day. Well, okay, I'm getting with the program here. What's your problem? I'll solve it. You know? Guys, she didn't want her problem solved. She just wants to talk to you. Ladies, when the guy starts coming at you with his problem-solving mode, it's just how he's wired. The Lord must have so much fun watching us. He made us in His image, and we both have these beautiful roles. It's really, really wonderful when it works right. The another part of the plan was procreation. Genesis 1:28, God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful, increase in number, fill the earth." God's plan for children, it's a mom and a dad. Have fun making those kids and have fun raising those kids. It's a blast. I love watching children in particular with their parents. Oh my goodness, they have so much fun. I mean, I realize it's not all fun, but I see these little kids running around and I see these young families. And then they start to grow, and they're in kind of the tween years, and that's good. And then you have teenagers and young adults. You know, some of that is challenging, but you know what? I love my boys, you know, most of the time. You know, they're really fun. And I'm so glad that I have had the privilege of having 8 children. People say better you than me. And you know what I say? You're absolutely right. You know, I have so enjoyed my family. This has been a blast. And it's God's plan for the family. Number 3 refers to relational intimacy. All right? I'm going to invite my wife, Sandy, to come up here and just share part of this sermon. Come on, let's go. How many people are glad you're not Sandy now? Raise their hand. Oh, look at that. Even the guys are raising their hand.
He never gives me a heads up about that.
You'd never come up if I told you what was coming. The Lord God said, it's not good for man to be alone, and I will make a helper suitable for him. Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and the birds in the sky. And he brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was his name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and the wild animals. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs, closed up the place with flesh. And then the Lord God made a woman from the rib. He'd taken out the man and he brought her to the man. The man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. And that's why a man leaves his father and his mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. Adam and his wife were both naked and felt no shame. Can you envision this picture that's happening in heaven? Now, what a wonderful, wonderful picture. I believe in the inerrancy of Scripture, but I also think that sometimes they leave out some verses. Alright? Let me pick it up with verse 22. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of man, and he brought her to man. I contend that there's a verse 22 and a half. It went something like this. Can I touch it? Finish out the service. Ladies and gentlemen, that's verse 22 and a half, and you're going to have to figure out 22 and 3/4 on your own, all right? Relational intimacy. God made Adam, and I think this is fascinating. He made all the animals next. And I don't think he was trying to be funny. I think he wanted Adam to thoroughly see that there was nothing whatsoever in the entire universe that was going to be a help meet for him like woman was.
Amen.
And so, personal, relational intimacy. And I think, and this one is huge too, and I don't think any of us know anything about this one to the extent that we're going to one day. It's also this physical relationship between a man and a woman, it's also a spiritual object lesson. We are to treat our relationship with Christ as seriously as we would a marriage. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother, and the two will be united. The two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery. And then the author here, the author Paul, is not talking about a physical relationship between a man and a wife. He said, this is a profound mystery. I'm talking about Christ and the church. This level of intimacy that is reflected in a good marriage, this same reflection is to be found between the church and the Lord. Amen. That wonderful mental, emotional, spiritual, and physical, not physical in the husband-wife sense, But we are to be involved with one another's lives, pouring love into one another, pouring love into our workplace, into our community, into our schools, with the same intensity and love as is found in a good marriage. Oh, this is a good, good God, you know, and He has just given us this physical intimacy, this relationship, this creation of husband and wife for beautiful things. Myth number two, Christian sex lives and lives and views are dull, boring, and out of touch. Here's the truth. Scriptures command God's people to be downright erotic in their marital love. Eros describes the physical relationship between a man and his wife. Let me share with you the first four verses of Solomon's Song of Songs. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your love is more delightful than wine. Pleasing is the fragrance of your perfumes. Your name is like perfume poured out. No wonder the young women love you. Gentlemen, I mean, there's clues right there to how to have a good relationship. I mean, the perfume of you is just like a living fragrance to me. Guys, you gotta quit walking around in essence of armpit, all right? Get some cologne. You want your woman to be excited about seeing you? Get some cologne out here, you know? Because look what happens in this next verse. Take me away with you, let us hurry. Let the king bring me into his chambers. This is a beautiful, beautiful book of the Bible. Most people have never read it. Let me give you a little disclaimer. It's a little bit like handling a handgun if you've never been instructed. You can shoot yourself with this thing. So Song of Solomon is kind of out of order. And the original intent is for one woman here. And it's just kind of a reflection not only of Solomon, but of Israel. We don't have time to get into this one too deep. But get this much about it, all right? The Lord is all for physical intimacy. One more disclaimer. This is written three times within the first eight verses. Daughters of Jerusalem, I charge you by the gazelles and by the does of the field, do not arouse or awaken love until it so desires. You see, there's a warning in there, all right? And this warning says, hey, this is something to be saved until marriage. So don't rush into this. And the same wording is used three different times. Let's check out a Sex in America study done by the University of Chicago in the 90s. University of Chicago is not particularly a Christian organization, right? But they did this huge, huge study. Here are some of the things that they have found. Extremely counterculture to media and pop culture are the following facts revealed by the study. Married people had sex more often. Sex in monogamous relationships was viewed as more romantic, satisfying, and fulfilling. Now, this was a huge study. This is kind of interesting and flies in the face that Christian sex lives are dull, boring, and out of touch. I would contend that just because Christians are a little embarrassed to speak about what's happening in the bedroom doesn't mean that there aren't good things happening in there. Right? Those who honor Christ's teaching have great lives together. Myth number three, as long as you love each other, sex is okay with God. False, the Bible prohibits all sexual relationships outside of marriage. Here's just a half a handful. It took me about 4 seconds to find them. You shall not commit adultery. Abstain from sexual immorality. Flee from sexual immorality. We should not commit sexual immorality. But among you, there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality. It is God's will that you should avoid sexual immorality. And that's just 6 verses fast. All right, but I am committed, those young people say to me when I'm talking to them as a high school teacher or as a pastor doing premarital counseling. I'm committed to this person. It's okay. It's all right. Isn't it? Well, no. And here's the problem. The commitment level is something that you can still walk away from. There is only one way to be committed: a public declaration, a legally paper documented of marriage, of commitment. Anything else is not committed. You're just playing. For those young people that are here, that, you know, you're still waiting for your special someone. That euphoria that you're feeling, you know, don't get me wrong, it's there and it goes and grows ever deeper. But here's the catch. The catch is, without that commitment, you're just playing at that relationship thing. If the person loves you enough to be with you, let's go, let's jump in. Because here's what the problem becomes. It's not going to take very long. I have seen, when I marry somebody, all right, so I come here and, you know, the people are all excited, and I count some man and wife, I always share this. So my warranty lasts until you hit that last chair. After that, you're on your own, you know? And so here's what's going to happen. Sometime between the last chair and the last dance, it's such a tension-filled day, you're going to have a fight about something, you know? I mean, maybe it gets you the first day. I guarantee you're not going to get through the first month, you know? Young people that aren't married, watch this. For those of you that are married, raise your hand if you've had a knockdown, drag out, want to kill your spouse fight. Rest of them, look around. Raise them high. They don't think you need to see this, all right? Everybody else is lying, all right? There are going to be times you don't like one another. I love the illustration of the three-stranded cord in Ecclesiastes. You know, one strand breaks easily. Two are not as strong as the third strand. And so with a public commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ and everybody else at that ceremony, here's what happens. You know? That little moment I had there with my wife, there's times that she wants to kill me. I can't help it. It's my spiritual gift. It's every man's spiritual gift. And there's times that I don't like her that good either, you know? But here's the cool thing about married, being married in Christ. Guys, it lets you off the hook. It's awesome. I don't have to be my wife's everything. Because I can't do it anyway.
Right.
And guess what? She doesn't have to be my everything. Because she can't do it either. That's unfair expectations. You put a marriage around the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you start working those principles into that, you get around other people that are believing the same things, you got marriage.
Amen.
You got marriage. You can lose your house, you can lose your job, you can lose your health, all that stuff can go south. Yeah, I ain't losing you there, babe. You said I do. And I know that we've got some bad days ahead here and there, but we got a lot of good ones too. And I might kill you one day, but I will never leave you. Did I say that right, Dave Wagner? I don't know. Maybe I better work on it. See, I got a little ways to go too. You get the picture though, all right? A public declaration is what it's about. Let's see, myth number four. Only a cosmic out-of-touch killjoy would prohibit sex outside of marriage. Here's the truth. God prohibits immoral behavior outside of marriage because He wants to protect us. He wants to protect us from the wages of sin, which is death. The gift of our God, our Lord Jesus Christ, is eternal life. Romans 6:23, that's what we want. Now here's what happens when you get involved in a relationship outside of marriage. There's that euphoria period, all right? Usually for a guy, it's about 90 to 120 days, all right? So ladies, just don't even blink or wink or anything at that guy until he's been around for about 4 months, all right? Because he's just floating in his heart right there, right? Let him get grounded. Be like the girl in England. Write the letters, you know? just keep those boundaries up. Do what Solomon told you to do. He said, don't awaken it until it's time, right? So give this relationship time to unpack a little bit. Because here's what you will be protected from. You will be protected from guilt, shame, flashbacks of relationships with other people, emotional scars, fornication, affairs. If you end up having a child, you know, child support. You are being separated from God's best. God wants to provide for you. Jeremiah 29, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. He has plans to prosper you, not to harm you, and plans to give you a hope and a future. But you're saying to me, Mike, you know, I hear what you're saying, but I'm looking across the fence, and man, there is green grass over there, and it looks really, really, really good. It is awesome. I'm telling you, that physical intimacy, that part of a relationship is awesome. But don't jump the fence until you have the license. Yeah. Ask these questions. And again, go back to Genesis. What does God's word say? How do I feel about it? Forget about this feeling thing. Don't do the feeling thing. It'll get you in trouble and it'll mess you up. What does God's word say? What does the feeling say? Ask the how's it working out questions. Right? And remember, Jesus is always asking questions all the time. So when you have those stirrings within you, or you're trying to help your children work this stuff out, it's hard for young people too. And again, we parents have done a horrible job of teaching our children about the physical part. Here are some questions that you might ask. Person that's considering an affair, how's that affair going to work out on your finances? You know, how's that divorce going to work out for you? How's the effect going to be on the kids? How's imagination sex with someone who isn't real or on some 900 number? Might even be a guy. How's that working out, hiding your secrets, trying to live a double life? How's that working out with the shame of a relationship? How does that work out to know that you're having sex with somebody that isn't your husband or your wife? Because that's what fornication is. You know, they're not your spouse. That's somebody else's spouse. You might not even marry them. Have you thought about how your thoughts are being controlled by sexual images that leave you with, you know, guilt, shame, you know? Ask some of those questions. Now, maybe there's some folks in here that are wrestling with some of that right now. This is a great place to stop. Let's quit. Confess and repent. Trust that God has a plan for you and He's going to make it great. And trust that He will transform your life. Be transformed. Romans 12:2. Renew your mind. Renew. Make it new. This is one of the beauties of Christianity. Doesn't matter what a shipwreck you are, the Lord can go just like this. And it is done. Confess your sins. Get right with God. But then here's the danger. Most people just leave the blank there. Don't leave the blank. Get into the Word. Get around some people that can help you. Go find somebody that's been married for 50 years. They know something about marriage. Talk to those people. Right? And renew your mind with a different way of looking at it. Don't get sucked in by the world's sales pitch. Right? For crying out loud, they use sex appeal to sell toothpaste. You know? That is not anything to base a relationship on. White, shiny teeth. Alright? Although, guys, if you do get involved with this woman, you probably should check out her dental structure because those root canals are expensive. So make sure that you got good dental insurance before you marry somebody that has bad teeth. Right? That one's free. Alright. Myth number 5. Everyone needs to sow their wild oats. The truth. Sexual sin is a uniquely devastating impact on people. Why? Because it's sin against the self. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Don't you know that he who unites himself with the prostitute is one with her in body? For it is said, the two will become one flesh. For whoever is united with the Lord is one with him in spirit. But pastor, I want to drive a car. I got to drive a car before I buy it, right? A relationship with another human being is not buying a car. Because guess what? Somebody's going to end up feeling like a used car if it doesn't work out. It's no good. Don't go there. Flee that stuff, the scriptures say. Flee sexual immorality. For a person who commits outside of the body, this is sin. But whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Spirit who is in you and whom you've received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. If you want to do a little more homework, go read Ephesians 5. That'll just really bring some of these thoughts right to the forefront. Sex sin is rooted in spiritual rebellion and idolatry. Right? And again, it's that me first attitude. It's disobedience to God's word. It is self-worship. It's not a place that a Christian needs to be. Now, you might be saying to yourself, I walked away from that, but I'm still slipping. I'm having troubles. There's lots of places to slip, ladies and gentlemen. You know, men, we are hardwired. Again, remember, we're problem solvers, and we are wired visually. Right? You got to have your flags up and your guards up. On guard, you know. There's going to be some times in your life when you're going to be tempted. Temptation is not falling in sin. And let's take it one step farther. Let's say that a bad habit that you used to have comes to the forefront. Let's talk about sexting. Let's talk about getting on the internet and being places that you're not supposed to be. If you have fallen or tripped once, that does not mean you're on your way to hell. It does mean you better put your antenna up and get yourself squared away. All right? So again, take steps. There are people in this church that know all about addictions, and they will help you out. Get involved with some of these people. Options for habitual sinning. There is one great one. Repent. Repent now. You can't claim authentic belief in the Lord and continue to sin. It's just not possible. Does the Holy Spirit live within you? Myth 6. Well, it's too late for me. My sexual sin is too powerful and nothing can loosen its grip on my life. I'm too far gone. No. Nobody is too far gone. Get honest with yourself, though. Psalm 145, verse 18. The Lord is near to all who call on Him and call on Him in truth. Are you ready to get done? Quit faking that you want to get over this thing. Just make that commitment, all right? Quit playing around with it. You're playing with snakes. You know? See, this is it. I'm absolutely, positively, 100% done. I'm not going to let this happen to me anymore. And then do whatever it takes to do the job. Whatever it takes. I knew a young man in a horrible problem with sexting. Horrible. And he had a beautiful girlfriend. Drop dead gorgeous, inside and out, this girl. And she found that sexting on his phone. It about killed her. Just about killed her. It about killed that relationship. And they kind of got over that little hump. And you know what that guy did? He and that gal took that phone, and they smashed it in the road, and they took the car, and they drove over the top of it. To my knowledge, the guy doesn't have a phone yet. Do you ever see Fireproof? Mm-hmm. When there was a guy that was getting burned with pornography on the internet. And it was destroying his marriage. And what did he do finally? I mean, he looked at that computer and he said, this is it. My marriage is more important than this stupid thing that's taking it down. And he picked up, you know, a $1,200 computer and he took it out in the yard and he smashed it with an axe. You know? Now, if you are familiar with that movie, his neighbor looked at him and said, what are you doing? But you know what? For that guy, the computer was poison. For that other fellow, the telephone was poison. The Lord said, if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off. Cut it off. Now, I don't know as he was literally saying, cut hand off. I think what he was saying was, you know what? That telephone that you have, if that's causing you a problem, you ditch it. If that internet's causing you a problem, get rid of it. If the computer's causing you a problem, forget it. You know? If you can't walk through the grocery store, find a line where those stupid tabloids are that kind of whisper to you. Find a line and go to the service counter. Whatever it takes for you to get away from sin, do it. Heads up, take a lesson from Joseph. What happened when he got grabbed by Potiphar's wife? That would have been pretty cool. Wow. You know, I mean, here's a guy far from home all by himself, and here's this beautiful woman, and she's got a hold of him. You know what he did? He ran. And he ran so fast that he left his shirt. You know, flee from sin. Yeah. Well, what have we learned here today? What we've learned, we're going to the church next door next week, because next week I'm doing homosexuality. So, you think this was bad? Wait till next week. Here's what I hope the takeaway is for you. I hope that you've realized that sex is sacred. It's an intimate gift from the Creator, used to cement and satisfy your need for a love built on permanence, security, and commitment. Sex is sacred. You and your beloved matter more than anything to the Lord. And don't settle for anything less. Lord, thank you so much for the opportunity to share and present this lesson. People are very patient. You know, Lord, just help us to have a right attitude about physical intimacy. Help us not to shy away from it. You created it for us. You want us to experience great joy in that relationship. But it's like a fire, Lord. Inside of a fireplace, it's okay. It's beautiful. Outside of the fireplace, that fire burns the house down. So, Lord, may we keep our relationship in the right place. And again, thank you for this opportunity to share. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.